If someone has breast cancer, they begin to have circulating tumor cells that circulate in their blood through early metastatic events. Being able to probe that can lead to two things. One is a new diagnostic for diseases like breast cancer, but also the ability to collect those cells that are unique to different types of patients. And we can use them because they're in live format to begin to study how they respond to different types of therapies. So it creates a new type of personalized medicine that currently doesn't exist today. And is very important because if you take something like breast cancer, where 70% of the population might respond to a given therapeutic regimen, why doesn't the other 30% respond? Well, they're genetically different. What will they respond to? How do we figure that out as opposed to putting them on needless therapies that aren't going to be effective? So this is, I think, a first shot towards, you know, having that type of capability. And so we're very excited about it, at the very least from a research tool standpoint, maybe from a medical diagnostic tool standpoint. Here's how spherical nucleic acids work with respect to creating cancer vaccines. We know that these types of structures are taken up by cells, including immune cells, and they're internalized via a process called endocytosis. Many of the toll-like receptors that one would like to engage to regulate the immune system are in the walls of endosomes. And so the spherical nucleic acids are exactly where they need to be to trigger an immune response. And so we can selectively engage these based upon sequence, and we can activate the immune system in a very selective manner. In addition, in a vaccine type of strategy, we carry with the spherical nucleic acid, oftentimes loaded on its surface through taking a peptide, for example, and hybridizing it to an oligonucleotide on the surface of the particle, a structure that will be processed by immune cells, antigen-presenting cells, where the ligand, the peptide, will be then placed on the surface of the antigen-presenting cell. With the immune system activated, T cells will dock onto the antigen-presenting cell where that ligand is, and the T cells, which are the killer cells, will be trained then to go out and search and only kill the cells that have those ligands. And so we've done this with lymphoma, and again, we've seen very, very good results in that regard, a model that many people use in the immune therapy space. And so that becomes a general strategy where you, spherical nucleic acid architecture stays the same. You're tweaking, let's say, TLR9, but you change the ligand based upon the type of vaccine response that you want. And so we've been going down that path and collecting data, setting the stage for clinical trials. But maybe the more exciting area is one that's about to go into clinical trials, and that's the idea of using spherical nucleic acids in combination with existing drugs called checkpoint inhibitors. There, we're trying to create therapeutics where we can tweak the immune system, for example, by activating TLR9 with a spherical nucleic acid, and give a patient or an animal that has the disease a checkpoint inhibitor that keeps the tumor cells from evading the immune system. In combination, those two actually work much better than alone. And so we can titrate the type of effect that we want. And the reason that's important, when we use checkpoint inhibitors alone, they actually work on quite a few people for different types of cancer, but they only address a small subset of the population. And one hypothesis is that the subset that's not being, where they're not being effective, does not have an immune system that's inflamed enough for them to be effective. So this gives you the ability to have the best of both worlds and to create a combination type of approach that gives you efficacy and safety all in one.